So recording here. So we're here with Yorick, developer, one of the lead developers from FreeCAD, and there's Jonathan on the call too with Open Source Ecology Community Manager. We're going to go over the plan of how we plan to transition pretty much to FreeCAD, an open source, highly extensible, very, very flexible platform for CAD design. It's early stages, but at this time studying it, you can see that it's got enough functionality that we can do a lot of the things we need to do, just about anything right now within it. So the concept is to collate all the work, all the different modules we've done in the tractor and the heavy machines, and to make it easy for people to design. What we simply want to do is put all of those into FreeCAD as library parts, essentially, so that people can essentially drag and drop into the working window, manipulate at the point where you have the parts already designed, which we have, like the universal rotor, like the frame modules, the various pivots, wheel units, universal rotors, power cubes. And let me give you a list of those. It's under part, I start a page called Part Library on the wiki. Let me send the link right there. But those are some of the parts we have already done. Go to opensourceecology.org/wiki, part library. Things like the power cubes, the tracks, backhoes, sprockets for driving the tracks, universal rotors, idlers, soil pulverizers, buckets and blades, rotors, pivots, etc. So by simply taking these parts, which are already engineered at a basic level, meaning that we know how to drive tractors, like for example with the universal rotor and a little micro tractor platform, we know we have 7,000 pounds of drive torque from the little micro track platform that we have tested last year. We have 27 horsepower power cubes, which we can stack. The most we've done to date is three of them, where we drove our tractor with the trencher with about 75 horsepower total power, things like that. So that's the part library. And as far as how that fits into, I mean, the vision is, if you give people the parts, then just like in Legos, you can mix and match. And because they've been engineered already, a novice can take that and start manipulating. So this is a way to generate mass collaboration. But the critical parts are, you gotta have the common platform that we're not messing around with. Okay, does it work? Can you even get the file to load? You know, SolidWorks versus SketchUp and this. And it's all the time it's been a bottleneck where some developer, like for example the CEB press, you know, some developer gets on it in SolidWorks and nobody really participates. It's nobody, you know, not many people have that platform and so forth. So to really foster the collaborative effort and get hundreds of people involved in this design, simple thing is to open up the part library and start designing many, many machines. So here's another, I'm going to point you to a roadmap on the tractor construction set and just briefly walk you through it, and the people who are watching going to watch this video. So it's called agriculture, kind of calling it the agriculture equipment construction set roadmap. Here's the link. But in this roadmap, it's 2016. So the first thing is to porting all of our stable tractor modules into FreeCAD. And in order to make it even easier for people not to mess around with even installing FreeCAD, the second step there is OSE Linux distribution. So simply a Linux version that you can download, and it has all the software, all the library parts, it has FreeCAD preloaded, and any other of the critical software that we use, like Caden Live, or maybe Natron, or whatever other, GIMP, and other things like OpenSCAD or whatever. Just all those typical packages that we use within Linux, so that if somebody wants to develop with us, there's zero time wasted. Because of course, I mean, in history, it's been that many, many hours are spent by everybody trying to get software to work, downloading stuff, and things like that. So this is about kind of really getting a lot of people on the same page with respect to common development. So that's where the OSE Linux comes in. And then the next step in there is FreeCAD in 2 minutes instructional. So there's a lot of instructionals out there on FreeCAD already. What we want to do is select about 10 of the key topics that we need, such as a sketcher, part design, path, workbench, etc. And create like the introduction, super fast-paced download in a very, very efficient way. Like we see about 10 of those videos, pretty much refactoring what all is out there. Like, for example, I watched this other video on a sketcher module. It's like 15 minutes. Well, let's get it, trim everything out and really, really make these very tight. I mean, they don't have to be super high quality in terms of the video or like editing, but they have to be very high quality in content transfer, just really blowing through all the concepts in as quick a way as possible, because if we assume that many, many people are going to be watching these, we don't want to waste people's times. So that's the roadmap part, FreeCAD in 2 minutes instructionals. Then the workbench, so basically the ability to put in the parts into FreeCAD and drag and drop them from the menu and start playing with them. So basically things like rotating, manipulating, moving around from existing parts, and possibly like if it's say the tractor tubing, the perforated tubing, we can, you know, make longer versions, shorter versions, etc. And it would be very easy to do that. So then after that, in order to get a lot of people on the same page, we got to teach people how to design things. So tractor design guide, gasifier design guide, universal rotor implements design guide, hay equipment design guide, multipurpose utility implements design guides. Basically, all the things we've learned about how these things fit together and what works and what doesn't, I pretty much need to record that. We need to collate all of that into usable guides that somebody can just take and be at our level in terms of understanding the rules of design that we've already seen work or not. So how do you make sure you have the basics of structural strength, speed, power, all of that, and hydraulics, etc. So, and after that, the other thing is we'd like to do is process guides. In other words, how do we go through this open source product development pathway with a lot of different complex moving pieces along the concepts of test-driven design? There's actually an initial diagram. It's on the wiki. It's called Priorities. But basically, it walks you through. It's a very, very rough guide, and I'm working on it right now, actually, as one of my key ways to get more people involved in understanding the overall process. But we have so here's a rough sketch of the test-driven design process, meaning you do partial prototypes and little tests and calculations and validations and as many steps as you can before you do the actual build. So that's conceptual diagrams, systems designs, evaluating conceptual working mechanisms, validation calculations. You can do simulations in 3D CAD. You can look at evaluating build procedures, optimizing bills of materials, optimizing workflows, just pretty much learning from industry standards as much as you can so that we can break those industry standards and redesign as needed if we need to. And that's, in general, that's consistent with our general development platform, which I have under development template. I'll just show you. Basically, whatever we do, there's a whole number of steps we do for open product development, and that's all those steps are captured in a development template. So that's that big spreadsheet of all the different things that we go through for developing every single machine. And basically, we set up one of these development templates for every module or every machine that we build. So that's kind of how the process works together. But we're going to try to teach people about that. And at that point, so maybe set up some webinars, like, for example, collaborative literacy webinars like this, where people can listen to how we collaborate on a massive scale, how to use common tools, and therefore we can do a large, you see that fork out in that picture there, that's about getting all the different, basically a parallel process of designing the next iterations of all the different machines, but more from the module level as opposed to complete machines. Like, we're going to talk about a basic tractor that Alec, who is here with us, he's our agriculture person, he's going to be using that in his operations. Simple things like loader bucket, hay cutter, hay rake, hay pickup, that's all like for the hay work, materials handling auger, bale compressor, knotter, conveyor belt, loader arms, backhoe boom and stick, backhoe bucket and grapple, quick attach plate, quick attach rotary joint, quick attach side-to-side pivot, universal implement bar, linear rail for moving implements, hiller, tooth bar for buckets, three-point hitch, bale spike, pallet forks, keyline plow with pipe layer attachment, and then all these universal rotor devices like pelletizer, shredder, post hole auger, ball mill, cement mixer, tiller, rotary hoe, winch, mulcher, limit, chipper, hammer mill, bale shredder, brush hog, and swing blade sawmill. So that's pretty much from these basic universal rotors and frames and power units, you can make all these devices, shafts, bearings. So those basic parts will go into the program. We're looking at possibly running a tractor build workshop this year if we get the tractor working well enough. Alec is here, so he's going to be running we're looking at right now at a chicken operation fed on largely on compost, but he's going to be doing a lot of moving of materials around, like the compost bales and turning the compost with a tractor, and we're going to have a three-point hitch on his tractor and things like that. So we're going to really test the tractor extensively this year in the practical application. So we're going to go forward with that and see if we can make it happen. So right now the practical considerations are getting the FreeCAD to a state where people can manipulate things in it as soon as possible with immediate applications to things like the tractor and all the other implements that we're interested in designing. With the universal rotor, like for example, to give you an example, a simple shredder, like if you Google a shredder, what it is, it munches up like cars or plastic or whatever. It's a basic rotor with these blades and some bearings and a box. And it's very simple to do conceptually. You can break it down. Okay, you've got this drive unit, this universal rotor, which we have. The only specialized parts is the blades that rotate against each other and so forth. But a lot of the things to build are conceptually very simple. If you have the building blocks to do them, they're relatively easy to pull off. And we think we can get a whole number of people to do that. And we're looking at the collaborative literacy webinars and restarting our design sprints on a weekly basis so that we can do some rapid prototyping here. So with that said, that's kind of the overview of where we are. So I want to ask you, maybe with respect to the OSE Linux part, the Linux part, as well as the basic instructionals, can you maybe walk us through, so there's some of the key workbenches, like there's the sketcher, there's part design, and tool paths actually for later, just simple cutting profiles for the CNC torch table. Would it be useful to maybe just maybe share your screen and show us at this point the basic capacity or the state of art of what FreeCAD can do right now? So, you know, like all the constraints within Sketcher, would that be something you can maybe show us and we can capture that? Like for example, Sketcher, looking at the videos, if you want to produce our super short 2-minute video, what all do we want to cover? So we can maybe go through some of the base functionality, and then we can refactor to a much higher quality video in the future. But the first thing being, like, for example, you have done the tutorial on the architecture for OSE, and actually I'll share that page with you. I put that all on the wiki. It's under FreeCAD. Let's see. The thing, I went through it, and it's, man, the FreeCAD is quite tricky indeed. Sorry. Sorry, say it again.
It's pretty complex.
Yeah, it's complex, but what I think can be done is if we can tell people, okay, set up this view, this, you know, like just the basic set, like I actually got stuck in the basic navigation within how do you, to give you an example, I started drawing the panel according to your instructional, and the first time I did it, everything was just blanked out. I restarted it and I did it again and it just worked, and I didn't really see what I did different. So it's there's a lot of subtlety, but I think if we can point people just very specific, okay, do this and do that and do that, then it's going to work. And I think that's, you know, we can really make that explicit. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, should I just change? I just changed my, because I use a dark background, desktop background, and it won't look nice in videos. So
yeah.
Changing.
So Jonathan's taken some notes. Jonathan, can you share that document with me? I couldn't get into it. Says you need permission. But anyway, we'll take some notes, and we're definitely recording this. I got a backup audio recording in case the screen...
Should I share my screen?
Yeah, please do. Yeah, why don't you share the screen, and we can go through what we can do now in Sketcher. Because basically, like, for example, I'll give you the... part library. Let's actually do a real part from our set, which is this plate. I'll give it to you. Stock bonding plate. Okay, right here. Let me send you this link. Sketching that out. How do we do that? This part right here. Because what we can do is we can readily take a part like this bonding plate that we should be able to generate in FreeCAD in minutes. And then extrude it to make it a real plate that we use as a bonding plate to bond two pieces together in our work. But yeah, I mean, if we can go through, there's much more that FreeCAD has in terms of functionality. So yeah, maybe if we could go through that in terms of the Sketcher. Okay, so we start. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I just gave a couple of basics. So for anyone who is totally new to FreeCAD, to explain, this is what FreeCAD looks when you start it the first time. You have this welcome screen, which usually is not useful at all when it's the first time you start FreeCAD, but after that populates with your latest files and stuff like that. But what's important is that FreeCAD is divided in... You're seeing my screen, right?
Yeah, yep, I'm seeing your screen. Mm-hmm.
So the... the important thing to know about FreeCAD is that its interface is divided between different workbenches, which are the parts, drafts, the little button on the top. I think you cannot see
that. I see file edit, view windows, yeah, macro.
Unfortunately, the Google doesn't show menus opening. But that's
it doesn't show menus opening there. You're actually opening the menu?
Yes.
Okay.
But unfortunately, Google doesn't show it. Anyway, that's where you change from parts.
Yeah, there's that.
And those are like specialties. Like it's a bit like one big workshop where each specialty has his own workbench. Like person who works with wood has his wood working table with specific tools for working with wood. The other guy has steel tools and a workbench specially made for with steel tools and so forth. The thing is that all these people can work on the same objects and on the same stuff. So you just change from one workbench to the other, and you still work on the same objects.
Yep.
And so it's basically a matter of knowing where are the tools you need. When you need to move, you need the move tool. Where is it? When you need the extrude tool, where is it? And that's the main difficulty for who is new to FreeCAD, is to know where to look for. Basically, if you go on the wiki, on the FreeCAD wiki, there are like tables of all the workbench and all the main tools that they contain. We're like working to make something like that better, and this is the big difficulty that the person needs to overcome at first.
Mm-hmm.
After that, once you know which tool is in which workbench, the whole workbench system becomes really natural.
That's right.
And also you can create custom workbench where you can pick tools from any other workbench.
Yep.
So you can also build your own workbench with your favorite tools from all other workbenches.
Mm-hmm. And
so
wiki is freecadweb.org.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's, yes, if you go to freecadweb.org, there is a link to the wiki.
Yep.
Basically, I'll explain you quickly the different workbench, the useful ones. The part workbench, I will create a new document here just to get rid of...
Yeah, and the first trick, by the way, when everything is blanked out, first thing you need to do is create a new document on the upper left-hand corner. That's a
main menu. Once you begin to use it a lot, you go to Edit Preferences, and in Documents, you check Create New Document as Startup.
Okay. Oh, that's good to know. Yep.
Annoying. The sub windows don't appear on the screen sharing.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, you make it start like this.
Can I interrupt you for a second? What version of FreeCAD are you using right now? And like when we put it on OSC's distribution, which version should we put up? 1.6?
Actually, since I'm developing FreeCAD, I always have the latest version. Yes, basically we have a stable version and we have a development version. The development version on Windows and Macintosh are made by hand. One of the community members builds it once a week, more or less. And if you're on Linux, there is an automatic build system on Ubuntu. Mm-hmm. So you need to add our PPA, and then you have a fresh version every day.
Do you know, let me ask you if we actually publish an OSC Linux, which we update every 3 months, every release, then we would just take the latest version and everyone, because we want everyone to have that starting. Nobody's messing around with downloading or making or installing, you know. So we just pick the...
The easiest way for me, or the best way, would be to compile FreeCAD yourself every 3 months and include that in your... So you will have bleeding edge FreeCAD, which is cool because there are like new stuff all the time.
Yep.
And it's it's actually very stable. It's very rare that the development version has big bugs that are not fixed the next day or something. So it's really stable.
Yeah, that's good. Mm-hmm.
So I go further. The parts workbench contains very simple tools like cube.
And that you just click different primitives there and you can get them in.
Mm-hmm. Yes, exactly. Or you select two objects and you have those Boolean operations like union or subtraction. Let's make a union. Here you can see in the tree view at the left that I have a fusion, which is one object now. And you can also, let's try removing a piece of it. I make a new cube. I will move it down by up or up, let's say. Then we can make...
Which navigation style do you like to use?
I like the gesture navigation, but it's really a matter of taste.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is what the Park Workbench does. Really simple, solid operations. Creates primitives, do subtractions, additions, and which is usually which is still called the CSG, like what is
CSG?
CSG for? It's constructive solid geometry.
Okay.
It's basically building objects by adding and subtracting primitives.
Okay. Can you show us maybe can you walk through really quickly through each of the icons there and demonstrate basically a survey of, in a minute, all the different functions that you have in this workbench?
Basically, you have the primitives, which are the yellow buttons, where you can make cube, cylinder, sphere, etc.
Yep.
Then you have two complex tools that allow to create more complex parts by, for example, selecting a face and then constructing a solid from that face. Or
what are those tools called? What's that tool, the first one?
The first one is, let me check in the menu.
When you hover over it, it shows you the name, right?
Do you see it?
No, I don't see I don't see it. It's not sure.
The first one is creation of parameterized geometric primitives.
Uh-huh.
And the second one is advanced utility to create shapes.
Okay.
And these are like widgets, but there is no point in opening it because it won't see the sub window. But those are like a wizard where you can select edges and of, let's say those are advanced object creation tools. You must explore it and you will see what it can do.
Yep.
Then you have all the blue tools, which are modification tools. You have one tool to extrude.
Show a quick example. Can you show a quick example of the extrude? Because that's one of the most powerful functions.
Let's make... I will use the
Can you click on the link that I sent you, the power cube? Can you just work with the example of the power cube frame, just basically a bunch of tubes with XYZ corners, if you click on the last link? Can you just basically sketch up a quick frame? Don't have to do the holes. So basically tubes that are at right angles to each other. So maybe show how that's done in this workbench, because this is probably the workbench you'd do it. You'd rotate things in here and make more complex objects.
Cannot open it.
It's just a wiki page, no?
It's a...
Click on the message from 11:28 a.m. That's PowerCube 7s.png.
Yes, it doesn't open here.
What? Doesn't open it. Try again, I just put it in again, no?
Okay, no, it works.
Yeah, just basically just the XYZ frame. Just show how, you know, you extrude one tube from a square.
Okay. Then you would use the sketcher, or better, the part design, because the part design workbench contains all the sketcher tools.
So you went to part design, but everything is blanked out right now. So what can you do?
It's because I have a task panel open, so I will close my task panel.
Okay, there. That's some of the tricks here. It's like, that's confusing.
Okay, so you see that the main tools are lit up, but all the sketching tools are great. This is because these sketching tools work inside Sketch. So first we need to make a new sketch. I press the new sketch button.
Okay.
I am inside Sketch.
Yeah, and that's...
Now you see...
Yeah. Okay. New sketch, remember that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Then we are inside Sketch. You see that the task panel is open.
Mm-hmm.
And you see that the geometry tools up there are lit, like the line, arc, etc.
Yep.
So basically, your shape, I would take... I would... Oh, stupid me, I just went out of the sketch. Okay. So since we need round corners, the best way, I think, would be to take the polyline tool and to roughly draw.
And not the square tool, not the rectangular tool.
Yeah, because the rectangular, you won't be able, or it would be annoying to make the round corner.
Mm-hmm.
So it's better to take this tool, and then by pressing M, you can change the mode of drawing, and then you can easily draw.
Oh, wow, yeah. Yeah, that's pretty powerful, yeah. Okay.
Then now I need to rectify all this, so I will take the horizontal edges and press the horizontal constraints.
Yep.
To make them horizontal. Oops. And vertical, vertical, of course. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now I need to pick these two points and join them with the point and point tool.
And to join, to select multiple things, you just hold shift, or how do you select multiple?
Well, with control.
Control, okay.
Now it's almost ready. Just need to fix the centers of the because otherwise.
Yeah.
Oh no, easier. I can take these two edges here, and add a. No, it's on the points. I must add here a tangency constraint.
Tangency.
Two curves and a point. Usually when you try to put a constraint and you didn't select the right number of things, it would tell you, like, you need to select one point and two edges or something like that, which is what I did now, and it told me, to make a tangency constraint, you need to select two edges and a point. So I did select these two edges and these points, and I could there place a tangency constraint.
Okay.
Now you see that my arcs, all the points of my arcs are tangent to the straight lines. So
all
the arcs are correct. So all I need to do now is to give the external dimension. I will take those two points here and put an horizontal distance. And let's give it 100 millimeters.
Yep.
I will...
That's about 4 inches, yep.
It would take much time to think in inches.
Yep.
Exactly the same. You can type inches instead of millimeters.
So you're selecting two points.
Vertical thing. So I will select one point on the lower line and one point on the upper line.
Yep.
And put a vertical distance constraint. Again, let's write 100 millimeters.
Mm-hmm.
So now we just need to give the radius of the arcs, and because at the moment they can still move.
Oh yeah.
So I take one arc and I press the radius constraint.
Uh-huh.
Let's it's like 10 millimeters.
Yep, that's about right.
Yeah. And it's the same for all the other arcs.
Mm-hmm. Yep, so you can fully constrain.
Not yet, because I can still move the shape around, but it's undeformable already. To it fully constrained, it cannot move anymore. So what I will do is place it here, and between, you see the dot that's the crossing of the axis, which is the 0, 0 point, the origin point, and I will constrain one of the points of my sketches to it with the point constraint. And now my sketch turned green, which means that it's fully constrained and I cannot move it anymore.
So you took a point on the anywhere on the shape and did the point constraint?
Yes.
Which
I constrained it to the 0, 0 point, which is at the center of the tool.
Sorry, can you point to the tool that you used for that? Is that the point tool?
Yeah. Right. The first one of the constraints.
Okay.
Coincident constraint on the selected item.
Okay.
That constraint basically takes two points and place them at the same location and bind them so they cannot move one from each other.
So for example, if we so with this, what you just said brings up a question. Like for example, if we're importing a library part, we want to import everything, or like if we say we have a complicated model in step file. And we want to import part by part to build the entire thing, the location will be saved in the export, so when you import all the parts, they will come into the correct place?
Yes.
Okay.
Basically, it depends. You can imagine another strategy and find a way to do another strategy, but if you just import one file into another, that's what will happen. It will come with all its constraints. So this sketch, if we import it in another file, will have all its constraints, and therefore will be locked to the 0, 0.
And does it accurately retain all that information, for example, from a step import, or does it lose information?
It loses information. Step file doesn't have any parametrics.
Which formats have parametrics?
None I know of.
So
I don't think it exists at the moment, any kind of exchange format that supports that kind of stuff.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. But FreeCAD, FreeCAD itself, of course, it contains that parametric information, but...
Yes.
So the only way you can have all the parameters is only if it's generated in FreeCAD. What about, OpenSCAD or something else? like Blender. No? It loses...
No, Blender doesn't use any of this stuff.
Yeah, right.
So there Blender is no way is to have it restored in Blender. OpenSCAD, it won't use this kind of constraints.
Okay.
Constraint sketch.
I see.
So you would need other... Basically, I believe, since the big advantage that FreeCAD is like very Python friendly, is that basically you could easily imagine exporter for any other Python application, for example, Blender, that would import FreeCAD files. That's pretty easy to do. And that would read the FreeCAD file and restore the constraints.
Wait, but for example, in Blender, it doesn't have the constraint-based mechanism.
No.
So
why would you need it? Actually, the idea would be that you would design in one piece of software, and you would export it to other pieces of software for a posterior operation.
Yeah.
And of course, the problem is that if many people are designing the same stuff with different software, that's a problem indeed.
Right. Right. But we get around it. If everyone in our team is using FreeCAD, then all the parameters are transferred from one file to another, and that's the only way to do it right now.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Or you must think of new systems. For example, I don't know. Imagine here, your step files would come together with a kind of text file, which would have some information in it that small scripts could open and recreate, I don't know, the correct location or something like that. But you would need to invent your own ways to do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. So going back to here, to part design workbench.
Okay. Then I was in my sketch. I just pressed the close button to get out of sketch editing. Then I have my closed shape. And I can use the path tool to create an extrusion. Let's make it.
So you didn't even use the extrusion tool, you did just pad.
Is a kind of super extrusion tool. The difference is that all the parts design work tools make some additional checks that the parts tools don't do. Let's say to resume that part tools are dumb and part design tools are intelligent. The advantage of using only part design tools is that it checks all the time that your objects are solid, which is of course useful when printing in 3D, for example.
Mm-hmm.
So if you use only part design tools, it will warn you when you're doing something that prevents your object to be solid. So, and that's pretty useful.
So part design as opposed to part workbench? Like, wait, you said part design versus which workbench?
Part.
Part versus part design. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Part is a kind of dumb workbench. Actually, it was made before all the others, and part is what provides the geometry to other workbenches. So if you want to do very simple things like CSG, like I was talking earlier, you would use part tools because it's quicker. Mm-hmm. If you want to do things right and constrain things, you would use part design because it's much more advanced.
Okay.
So let's stay in part design.
Mm-hmm.
So now we want to make a hole in that shape so it's hollow. So to do that, the best way is to make a new sketch on this face. We will draw another sketch, which is a bit smaller than the one we did, and we will then carve the first shape with it, so we have a hollow shape. So this is done the same way. You select the face, and if you have a selected face when you create a new sketch, this is what happens. Your sketch,
so you sketch
already
on
created that face.
Mm-hmm.
So I will do same thing here. I take my wire tool. And I draw M.
So you don't use an offset tool. Is there an offset tool?
There is, but not parts, not part design. And I want to stay in part design. So, and you will see that this is a pretty cool way to work, actually.
Mm-hmm. So you're doing all the constraints again.
Yes. But you see, it doesn't take much time, actually. And what I will do here, which is interesting, is that I will constrain my inner shape on the other shape, on the outer shape.
Yeah, you got the tangency there. Mm-hmm.
Yes, move it inside. What I can do is import edges from the face, from the base face. To do that, you take this tool above that's create an edge link. Create an edge link to an external geometry. That's the little blue box tool.
Hmm.
And with that tool, you can select edges from your base shape. They are in colored in magenta.
Mm-hmm.
These edges are hidden. They won't render in the final geometry when I will go out of edit mode. They will only exist inside the edit mode. But I can use them to place constraints. So what I will do is take a point from the upper edge and one from the external edge, and I put a vertical distance here of, let's say, 4 millimeters.
Uh-huh.
Same here, at the bottom, 4 millimeters. And you see, that's the interesting way to work. I need to import the vertical edges. Okay.
Can you make it 6 millimeters? Because that's actually the real size. It's about 6 by 100 millimeters. Mm-hmm.
Okay. 6.
It's about a quarter inch.
And again, horizontally, 6, and here, 6. I need to fix my arcs as well. Well, I think I'll just put a radius again. That will be the quickest way of 4 millimeters, which is 10 minus 6. It will be quicker than trying to constrain each. Ready. And you see that since my inner shape is bound to the original one, it's already constrained. Fully constrained, because it cannot move anymore, because I used the external edges.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. So basically my first sketch is controlling everything.
Yeah.
As long as I am building new sketches on top of this existing object, they will all be constrained all the time. That's a big advantage of this method, is that all your sketch, your successive sketch, are always fully and correctly constrained.
Yeah. Yeah.
And if I have to move my base sketch, everything will move correctly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now I will use this new sketch to create a pocket, which is the second button next to the pad.
Mm-hmm.
And the pocket is actually a subtraction.
Yeah.
And I can give it a distance. I think I made it 300 millimeters. Yeah, it's hollow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And part design has rotation?
No, but as always in FreeCAD, you just rotate stuff by rotating its placement.
So how do you do the XYZ corner here from this? You got one tube, now XYZ corner from this tube. That's one of the standard geometries we use.
Okay, so what would I do here? Actually, I would use. You could just copy this whole thing aside, the base sketch, and rebuild the whole thing. But I would prefer to use a kind of little helper, which is in the draft module, and you have this Star Wars
clone
icon.
Yeah, the clone icon.
Clone. And clone is cool because it creates, selecting objects. And now I have two objects, the pockets, which is my final object I did earlier, and the clone. And the clone is a linked copy of the original object. And I can change its placement. Now let's put it like 20 millimeters. And I have two linked objects, the clone and the original one.
They are linked?
And yes, if I change the first one, like for example, let's change the height of it.
Oh, I see.
I will change the pad height to 400.
Oh, I see, they're linked.
The clone.
Mm-hmm. Does that mean the rotations is also linked? Or no? No.
What? Sorry?
So that means if you rotate one, you rotate both?
No. The placement is independent. Only the shape is
the
same. I need, of course, to make my pocket also 400. So you see that I moved the clone.
Yeah.
I can also rotate. You can do that by modifying the placement. For example, I would give it a 90 degree rotation on the Y axis. I did this. I can also use draft rotate tool that would do that graphically. I'm struck in my
Is that a you running into a bug?
I've wiped my FreeCAD configuration before doing this exercise, and now my snap tools are like messed around, and the draft rotate tool uses snapping. This back in auto. Okay, now it works. So with the draft tool, with the draft rotate tool, you can do that graphically.
Mm-hmm.
Which can be, it's less precise than using the placement, but it's easier.
Yeah.
I mean, there are times when you want to set your rotation manually by modifying the placement. Other times when you prefer to do that. Like that. So basically, I will undo my rotation, and let's say I want to place this tube more or less like in your example. I would do that, I think, just manually.
Do the round corners make it more difficult to snap at precise places?
No, because Let's try. Remove it here for now, and let's say I want to snap this point. Take the move tool. This point.
You're taking a point or the face?
A point. When you use the snap tool, you will see what it takes. Like, I will do it again. I select my object. I select the move tool.
Uh-huh.
And then when close to this point, I don't know if it appears.
Yeah. Yep. The point appears, right? I see it.
Yes.
Point
and you
appears.
Have that small icon that shows you endpoints. So you know that you picked the endpoint here. And then I can move it here, where it will snap to the endpoint as well. Now I have both perfectly in place.
Except they need to be a little further around that curve. You have to move it further.
So I can move it simply.
Just by
that.
Hand?
Yeah, and I'm doing it just by the eye now. But you could always, after that, go here to your placement and change the values manually.
Mm-hmm.
To make exactly where you want.
By hand, it's a little tricky to get around that round corner, isn't it? Or...
No, not necessarily. Also because you can do this.
Right, you select the whichever view, X, Y.
Object, I take the move tool, I take one point here, and if I press shift, I will constrain the move horizontally.
Mm-hmm.
While I press the shift, the object cannot go in any other direction than horizontally. So I can now pick a point here.
Okay.
Things are perfectly
aligned.
Yeah.
And you chose the different XZ plane by one of the boxes on top there, the different orientations.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
For this to work, obviously, you need to be in a top view or front view or one of the view like that, so you are sure that things are aligned visually.
Mm-hmm.
But if you, for example, let's say that this point here at the crossing of these two green lines would be at 0, 0, then it would be pretty easy to place this one also at 0, 0.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Even if you don't use those draft tools, there are ways to work around and to make it work. So this is basically how it works. If I want to do like the circular holes here, it's pretty easy as well. And I will go back to part design, select one face,
mm-hmm.
new sketch, circle.
And then constrain the circle?
Yes, import an edge from here, then
you did that blue, the blue thing with the line above that. How do you import the edge?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
I import the edge of the face I used to place the sketch. Then I take center point and
mm-hmm.
one of the points
yep.
here, and in horizontal distance I will put 40 here. And let's put a vertical one as well of, let's say, 80.
Mm-hmm.
And I need to constrain the circle, say, 24.
Yeah, it should be 25. Yeah, 25.
25. All right, it's fully constrained.
Wait, 25? I thought it was 100 across. Oh, yeah, so it would be half of 25. So 12.5.
Uh-huh. All right, let's leave it like that at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
Then we do another pocket.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's 100 millimeter.
That's more than a thickness. Oh, yeah. Oh, no. So you went through the both of them at the same time. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we can copy this feature. This pocket can be copied around. I can do that with the linear pattern button that's above there.
Linear pattern that you're pointing to?
Let's create a linear pattern feature. With my pocket selected, I can do this. You see on the screen that it's trying to make a copy, but this copy would make the wall shape not solid anymore. So it's red, and it would. It tells me when I'm trying to do something that prevents the shape from being solid.
You mean it tries to do that on a tube that's horizontal, not vertical?
Yes. You see here I switched horizontal
mm-hmm.
axis to vertical sketch axis. And now the hole, the copied hole is at the right place.
Yeah.
And it's not wrong anymore, so it doesn't complain anymore. The thing is, it will complain when you try to do something that prevents the shape from being solid, which is pretty useful.
Yeah, yeah.
That would be like three copies. I need to give it more than 200, I guess.
Yeah.
Let's make it 2. No. Okay, you see that the clone wasn't updated.
Yeah.
This is because the clone was made from the first pocket. No, not from this latest pocket that we did. But this is easy to change. We can take... No, it's not easy to change. No, sorry.
You made it from the second...
But
you made it in
a... at the moment.
I see. So you changed the clone, not the original, and that's why you didn't do both?
Yes, and the clone is looking at this object, the pocket. And then we built further stuff on top of that pocket. We built the holes. So this pocket is still there. If I hide my linear pattern, the latest one, and I show the pocket, it's still there. That's what we use to make the clone. After that, we built more objects, and it's a new object. So actually, we need to change the clone to reflect that. Unfortunately, at the moment, you cannot do it by hand. You have to do it by small line of Python.
Oh, really? You're going into the Python?
This would be pretty easy to do a little macro. That's the cool thing about Python and macro in FreeCAD. You would need this one line thing, and I could do it for you, and you would save it, and you would save it in your macros, and you would have that tool. Now I will do it quickly. Clone objects is
app, activate document, clone object. That's.
I need to recompute. Right. What I did is to change the base object of the clone and use the linear pattern object instead of the pocket.
That's advanced features. Yeah. If you wanted to do. If you wanted.
FreeCAD is lacking those small, you know, those small utilities to do those stuff that they're easy to do by Python. So it's just like workmanship that's needed to add those hundreds of needed small features to FreeCAD. But you see, they're all there. It's just a matter of the application maturing until it becomes something easy for non-programmer to use. But we're actually pretty close to it. And so yeah, all time you will miss those small things that you're missing. Probably if you don't know that that's Python, you would need to delete the clone and you do a new one. But this will come with a bit more, and all this at some point will be there.
Yeah, I mean, that's stuff that's entry level additions that. Regular programmers, I mean, not someone who knows CAD programming, it's a very basic function someone can do in Python.
Yes.
Yeah.
Someone who knows a little bit of Python will already find how to do it, because quickly you will know from here, because that Python console here below teaches you all the time.
Yeah.
If you keep this Python console open, which I recommend,
you look
see
at the functions.
The Python code unfolding, because every time you press a button, on FreeCAD, some Python code is executed. Actually, the glue between the application and the interface is that Python window. Every time you press a button, some Python code is printed here.
Yeah.
Which is what is used to record macros.
Is there?
But you can.
Go ahead.
Go ahead. And so you can quickly understand what's happening.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It helps you. Like you begin to type app dot. and it opens this little window that tells you possible completions. And there is even help. It does, the help doesn't appear on the screen. There, but every time you select one of those, you have a help string appearing. So it's really easy to learn. If you just know a little basics of Python, in no time you understand how FreeCAD works and how to add the simple things.
So for example, things like making this animate, so just move this pixel by pixel, is that through command line, or does a window already exist for that? You know, like take them apart and put them together in an animation. You can do that through Python?
There is a plugin, actually. If you go on the FreeCAD GitHub pages, we now have, let me give the link.
For exploded part animations, I've seen some excellent videos from CAD1919 on YouTube doing all kinds of nice exploded part animations.
Let me share my... I will give you the link. It's easier. That's the main GitHub page of FreeCAD. We have the FreeCAD code, which is the FreeCAD repository. And we have a couple of others that will interest you, I think.
GitHub.com/FreeCAD.
Yes.
So
then there you have the FreeCAD itself, the code. And then you have the library, which I believe will interest you a lot. Click on it.
FreeCAD library.
You will see the repository of parts.
Yeah.
And the cool thing is that it's insertable in FreeCAD. Unfortunately, I have lost my settings. But once that parts library is installed in your macros.
Okay. You can pull parts from it automatically over the internet?
So basically what you need to do is to copy that whole... you can press the download zip button and copy that whole stuff on your computer. And there is a macro, the FC macro file, that you can copy inside your... I will do...
Okay. I'm not seeing your screen anymore.
No, I just switched it off. I will just restore my settings so I have it and I don't need to download it again right now.
Yeah.
Okay.
What I'd like to do is, maybe for next time, I'd like to write a tight 2-minute script for the sketcher, and maybe you can review that, and we can actually do that, make a nice quick video.
So once that library is installed,
you can drag and drop, or you can, how do you do it?
Yes.
Oh, wow, so it already appears. Oh, that's excellent.
And
so,
then, yes. That's, I believe that's what you wanted.
Yeah, exactly. So we can basically drag and drop. Now, where would I create this directory? Can I put it into the library over your GitHub, or how does that work?
You can either add to our library, or you can have yours, which follows the same... But it's simple.
It's simple?
There is a folder with FreeCAD files inside. That's no more than that. And so you could build yours, and they can be added together.
Is this what you're pulling down? Is that in real time downloading it, or it downloaded everything already at once?
No, it downloads it. We use Git, actually. So
right now you're using Git to download from GitHub from within FreeCAD.
Yes.
Very powerful.
Basically, here everything is going to be downloaded on my computer.
Nice.
But we also made that's the next thing I will show you. We have this new, you won't even see it, of course.
That's great. So we can basically create our own library and start putting parts in.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And we have now an automatic installer for this library and for other add-ons. If you go back to the FreeCAD GitHub page, next to the FreeCAD code and the FreeCAD library, you have another one which is FreeCAD add-ons.
FreeCAD add-ons,
and
yes.
And this one contains additional workbenches that are not included in FreeCAD itself because they are made by other people. But we try to gather them here.
So why are they not in an official version? Because what's the procedure for accepting them into the official version? Or are you trying to keep the official version simple?
Yeah, it's more because it's a hassle for everybody. I mean, if someone is developing a workbench and he wants to have it included in FreeCAD itself, that there is all a system of pull requests. You must request for having your code merged. Mm-hmm. And if the person works all the time on this workbench, you will have to do like hundreds of pull requests, and that's a hassle for everybody. So we thought it's easier to have people work on their own stuff like they want. Mm-hmm. They have their own GitHub repository. And it's easier to work that way. So user installs workbench. And so it's faster for people to develop. It's less work for us. And actually, it works.
Do you approve? So who approves what gets into the FreeCAD add-ons? Is that anyone can put stuff in there, or you just approve it?
Just asking. I mean, you have to have your workbench on somewhere else, on another mm-hmm. GitHub stuff. And you ask us to insert it here, and I do it. And it's actually, they are not physically there. This FreeCAD add-ons is a kind of virtual collection.
Okay.
If you click in any of them, it goes to the GitHub repository of the person who's developing it.
Okay.
It's just a system of GitHub offers that you can insert one repository inside another. That's what we use here.
Mm-hmm.
But the cool thing, at the bottom of this list of add-ons, you have a macro, which is add-ons installer .hc macro. You just download that macro and you place it in your macros folder of FreeCAD.
Uh-huh.
And after that, it can install any of these add-ons automatically.
Uh-huh. And they will appear as new workbenches? Those are all workbenches?
Mm-hmm.
Very nice.
You can you install it, install it.
Are they any well documented on a FreeCAD wiki, or documentation sucks?
Pretty new, like 1 month old, so not yet. We're still testing it and making sure it works on every platform, but it will be.
Yeah.
And my idea is to add that macro inside FreeCAD. So you would open FreeCAD and you would already be able to install additional plugins from there.
Okay.
No need to go on site or anything.
Yeah.
I think that would be really easy.
Okay. And so for example, with the tractor parts, if we get them into FreeCAD format, and there's a folder of them, what would I do? Would I tell you, okay, hey, Jörg, can you put it into your library set, or how would I do it?
No, we would publish it on your Git repository somewhere,
and you can,
being GitHub, being your own Git server, anything, and just tell me.
Okay.
And I would include it.
Okay. Excellent.
And, that I think that's the best way to work. Like everybody works on his own stuff, and at the end they're all bound together.
Yeah.
And so my permission, I don't need to wait for you to do something. Everybody works on its own pace and they all work together.
Yeah, that's great. And that's one example of excellent collaboration across many people, which you don't find in a proprietary project. You don't just add new features to a proprietary package or something. Mm-hmm.
You can also, if you have like pretty generic parts, screws, commercial pieces, have them included in the FreeCAD library, in our library as well. It's just making a pull request and we add it. And we can even give you the right permission to that.
Mm-hmm.
It's just if you have interest in something to do.
Yeah. No, that would be very useful. Like, for example, pull down like all the bearings, hydraulic motors, cylinders that we use, and everyone has ready access to them. And then that way you can control allowable, admissible parts. Yeah, which is good.
what we usually do, this library is just a structure of folders, and in each folder you have FreeCAD files. But we try to put a FreeCAD file, a step file, and a STL file. The FreeCAD file is obviously to directly import in FreeCAD. The step file is so that people can use it in other software. And also because the step file loses its constraints. And so sometimes it might be more interesting to insert a non-parametric part because they are more a little bit lighter. So if you have both the FreeCAD file and the step file, you can choose which one you insert in your drawing, the parametric one or the non-parametric one, which can be useful.
So basically the non-parametric ones you prefer just so that they're just faster?
Yes. Of course, for a small tube, there is no difference. But imagine for a big machine, that would make a difference. All the steps are there, or if you have just one step object.
So the strategy would be, like, if we do a complex full machine, you want to just maybe take the parameters out of it once it's done so people can work with it?
Exactly. That's what the assembly workbench will do when it's ready, automatically. But for now, you can just fake it like doing that. You save a step version of your file, and you have a lightweight version of your file. That works.
So right now, can you take what you just drew, the tubes, and generate a WebGL file out of that?
Yes, I can. We have... no, because I closed the file. Without saving.
Okay. But you would be able, in principle, to get the WebGL out of that and embed it in a wiki and manipulate it in 3D?
Yes, we have a simple WebGL exporter, which creates,
I saw it. It's one of the...
A full file with... But it's not very... I mean, nobody worked much on that because I think nobody found that...
How come? I mean, to embed things within just, you know, say WordPress or wherever, I mean, it's not that useful? Why is it not so useful?
Usually WebGL is not very easy to manipulate. It is becoming, but at the
it's just too large file size? Files too large? Files too heavy? Files too big?
Browser still slow to rotate stuff, and the aspects of the lines not very sharp, and so it's a bit garbled. Or you must remove the lines, and then it's not very nice for technical objects. Nobody found it very practical.
Okay. Yeah, it's not really there yet. Okay. So
The third format that we add is STL.
Yeah.
That is because GitHub shows the STL.
It shows them, yeah.
That's interesting. If you go in the part library on GitHub,
it will show it.
Click on the file, it will show you it. It will show it to you in 3D. So I think that's more useful than the
yeah, it's good to have a visual representation. And you can embed that in, for example, in a wiki, you can embed that STL. I think you can just embed it.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah. That's great. Okay, I got to get going here. We don't want to take too much of your time, but can we maybe talk next? Can we set up a call for next week to continue?
Sure.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Would the same time work for you next time?
Let me just check. Yes.
Let's do it. In the meantime, we'll try to make a refactor what you just showed us, see if we can replicate it and come back to you with questions and work on a 2-minute instructional on a sketcher. We'll do that.
Okay, one last thing. I think I told you about that.
Yeah.
Working on a kind of manual.
Oh, yeah. That's right. How's that coming?
Pretty nice, actually. This is the link.
All right.
On the bottom link, you can already read it online. And it's about 70% ready already.
FreeCAD manual.
There is a Git book link at the end of the text below.
Okay, at the bottom there's a Git book. Okay.
Yeah, and that will allow to read it online already. So this is pretty useful already.
All right, excellent. And you've got pictures in there, let's see. Yep, you got pictures. Good.
Look at, for example, the 2.4 chapter.
Modeling for product design. Yep.
Once.
For example, do you go through the sketcher workbench, like some of the things you explained here? Yeah,
yes,
that's good.
Look at chapter 2.4.
That's okay. That's a good one right there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, excellent. That's a great. Looks good. See if we can replicate that. Oh yeah, good example. Okay, well that's excellent. So that's for people to find it. That's Yorick's GitHub, which is github.com. Yorick Van Haver. And FreeCAD manual. / FreeCAD manual. So in Yorick's repository, FreeCAD-manual. Like this, FreeCAD-manual. Okay, we'll put a link on that. We took some notes. Okay, excellent. So same time next week would work for you? That's all good?
Perfect.
Excellent. Excellent. So thank you for your time. Yeah, we'll keep working it. We're going to start generating the library and see where we go. Thanks so much for your time. This is good. Yeah, no, I'm pretty... Yeah.
Bye, guys.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, man. That's very, very informative. I think it's amazing. You're doing great work. And thank you so much for showing us these shortcuts and everything. I mean, it's mind-blowing and seeing the things you can do. So thanks again for taking the time.
Okay.
Cool. Thanks for listening.
Okay. Thanks. Take care.
See you around.